Hello everyone. In this video, we will be solving GATE 2004 questions from the computer network subject, and we will be discussing about the network layer as well as the transport layer. So here we will be discussing about the GATE 2004 only. So let us look at the very first question. It is saying, which of the following is not true with respect to transparent bridge and a router? So here you should know what is the difference between a bridge and a router. So because the question is about bridges and routers, so you should know the difference, right? If you do not know the difference, then you will not be able to solve this kind of questions. Now this router works in three layers. It works in physical layer, data link layer, as well as the network layer. It does not work in the transport layer. It can read in the data packet everything up to the network layer. But when we discuss about this bridge, now bridge only work in two layers. It works in the physical layer as well as it also works with the data link layer. It does not work with the network layer. Therefore, all the information that is present in the network header, the bridge cannot read. Okay. Now let us read out the options. The option number one is saying both bridge and router selectively forwards the data packet. So this is actually true because both bridge and routers, they can drop a packet which is not meant to be sent again, I mean on the other side. So this is true because they can drop a packet according to the requirement. Second, a bridge uses IP addresses while a router uses MAC addresses. This is wrong because a bridge only operates till the data link layer, and in the data link layer we use MAC addresses. And router operates till the network layer, and in the network layer we use IP addresses. Hence this option number 2 here is false. This is wrong. Option number 3, a bridge builds up its routing table by inspecting incoming packet. This is true because in case of bridge we also have a concept of self-learning bridges. Okay, so in case of bridges you may find out that they can build their own routing table by inspecting the incoming packets. And number 4, a router can connect between LAN and a WAN. That is also true because generally you see a router connects your own network, your own computer to the internet. So that is why a router can connect between a LAN and a WAN. So correct answer here, because they are asking which of the following is not true. Only option number 2 is not true, otherwise option number 1, 3 and 4 they are true. Let us look at the next question here. They are saying which one of the following statement is false. So the statements are as follows. The TCP guarantees a minimum communication rate. TCP ensures in-order data packet delivery. TCP reacts to congestion by reducing the sender window size. And TCP employs a retransmission of compensate for packet loss. And they're asking which of the following is false, right? They're not asking true, so do not confuse it with true. So option number 1 says TCP guarantees a minimum communication rate, and here they are saying guarantees a minimum communication rate. That means, for example, a certain application wants that we should have at least 600 kbps of speed, or can say communication rate, or can say bandwidth. So this is at least the someone is expecting, but this is not correct. So here TCP does not guarantee a minimum communication rate. Why? Because we have a TCP congestion control algorithm, and according to the congestion in the network, the data communication rate can be reduced. And this is a very, very easy thing, right? So you can also write a small point of this. So TCP does not guarantee a minimum communication rate. A sending process here is not permitted at any ascending process is not permitted to transmit at any data rate that it want, at any rate it pleases. Okay, so sending process is cannot decide the minimum communication rate, because here we have congestion control algorithm, and according to the congestion in the network, the TCP automatically increases or decreases the congestion window size. So here the option number 1 here is false. Now let us look at the option number 2. TCP ensures in-order delivery, that is correct, because here in TCP we use sequence number field. So sequence number field is used so that we will be able to sort the data packets. And here in-order delivery means, because in case of TCP we are having a virtual circuit, we are going to establish a virtual circuit, and because of that virtual circuit again TCP ensures the in-order delivery. But again, because TCP uses the services of IP, the packets may not reach in order, the packets may reach out of order, but with the help of sequence number field we will be able to make the packets in order. Hence, for the option number 2, here you can see for the option number 2 the correct answer is this is correct. Okay, now let us look at the option number 3. TCP reacts to congestion by reducing sender window size, and that is correct, because in case of TCP we are going to use the congestion control, and in the congestion control we have various congestion control techniques. For example, here we have slow start phase, then we have reduce phase, and so on according to the congestion that we may find in the network. And the fourth one is the TCP employs retransmission of compensate for packet loss, and this is also true. The reason is, whenever a packet is lost, in that case we send the packet again, and this packet loss is actually taken care with the help of this packet loss here, it is taken care with the help of your acknowledgement. Okay, so that means whenever a sender is sending some data to the receiver, and the receiver is going to send an acknowledgement. So if the acknowledgement is not received by the sender, that means sender can send the packet again. With the help of these acknowledgement, we can ensure that no packet should be lost. So TCP employs retransmission, that is correct, to compensate for the packet loss with the help of a mechanism called as acknowledgement. And TCP reacts to congestion window, this is also correct, because this is a congestion control algorithm which is having various phases, slow start phase, additive increase phase, and so on. So here you can see option number 2, 3 and 4 all are true, only the option number 1 is false. So correct answer here is 1. Now let us look at the next question here. It is saying a subnet has been assigned a subnet mask of 255.255.192. What is the number of hosts that can belong to this subnet? So first of all, you should know that this subnet is for the class C subnet, as this is a 2004 question. They are not actually telling what is how many bits are there in the subnet ID, or you can say network ID. But we are assuming, because here the first three octets are having a value 255, that is why it is a class C network. Okay. Now, because it is a class C network, secondly, this class C network is now divided into subnets, or subnets means this is divided into smaller networks. Now we have to see, out of all these smaller networks, how many subnets, how many networks it is divided into. So we are using 192, and this 192 can be written as 128 plus 64. So you can easily see it is as 11000000. I mean, the last octet, we have divided the last octet into this binary format, and this binary format is representing the value which is 192.2. Okay. Now, in this case, we can easily see. Now let us look at this question. They are saying a subnet has been assigned a subnet mask of 255.255.192. What is the maximum number of hosts that can belong to this subnet? So you should know what is a subnet mask. So in case of subnet mask, we make all the network ID bits as 1. We make all the network ID bits as 1. And all the host ID bits are 0. Host ID bits are 0. Okay. And if you just see this subnet mask, you can clearly see how many 1s are there. So the first octet here is 1111. 1111 dot, this is the first octet, this is the second octet which is 1111 1111 dot, this is the third octet which is also 1 1111 1111 dot, In the fourth octet, we have 1100000. So here you can clearly see that in this entire IP address, we made the first 26 bits as 1. Therefore, these first 26 bits are representing your network ID, and only the last 6 bits are 0. Therefore, these 6 bits are representing the host ID. Now, because they are asking how many number of hosts can be there, so with this number of bits, we can have 2 raised to power 6 hosts. But in these 2 raised to power 6 hosts, we do not use 2 IP addresses, because the first IP address belongs to the network ID and the last IP address belongs to the directed broadcast address. Hence, we only use 2 raised to power 6 minus 2 hosts, which are basically 64 minus 2, which is 62. So correct answer to this question is option number C, that is 62. I hope this is very easy question. Look at the next question. In TCP, a unique sequence number is assigned to each byte. Very straightforward question. So in networks, we generally do not discuss about words, and we do not discuss about the message. So you know that we have TCP, which is a byte stream protocol. That means we are going to count every byte. This IP is a packet stream protocol. So we are going to count every packet. So when they are saying the sequence number field here, we give the sequence number field in case of TCP, we give the sequence number to every byte. But in case of IP, you give the sequence number to every packet. So correct answer is option number 1. Next, in TCP/IP protocol suite, which one of the following is not part of the IP header? So in case of IP header, they are asking about the IP header. Make sure they are not asking about the TCP header, but rather they are asking about the IP header. So in case of IP headers, we'll be having a fragment offset, we'll be having a source IP address, we'll be having a destination IP address, but we do not have destination port number, because this destination port number is in the TCP header. It is not in the IP header. So correct answer is option number 4. Let us look at the next question. A TCP message consists of 2100 bytes is passed to IP for delivery across two networks. The first network can carry a maximum payload of 1200 bytes per frame, and the second network can carry a maximum payload of 400 bytes per frame. Now, excluding the network overhead, assuming that IP overhead per packet is 20 bytes, what is the total IP overhead in the second network for this transmission? So that means a host is sending a message. Now this message will be sent through the first network, which is the network A, and then this message will be sent through the second network, which is the network B. Now the total size of this packet is 2100 bytes. Now they are asking what the total IP overhead in the second network, in this network, what will be the total IP overhead, and this is the total data. Okay. Now here what you can see after reading this question is they are giving us an IP overhead, but they are not giving us a data link overhead. So IP works in the network layer, and in data link layer it's also having its own header, but they are not talking about the network data link header. That is why we are not going to consider it. So how will you solve this question? So this is data from the application layer, maybe your TCP. This is a data from the TCP layer. Now this data will travel to the network layer. In this network layer, we are going to add 20 bytes of, just rub it up so that I can make it clear. So you can see we have total of 2100 bytes, and this is a TCP data. Now this TCP data will be given to the network layer. So this network layer is going to add its own 20 bytes of header in this. And then further, this will be given to your data link layer. So data link layer will receive 2120 bytes, but they are not giving us the data link layer header size. Hence, we are going to imagine that this size is negligible. Okay. Again, you can take this. This should be 20 bytes, but they are not giving us. Hence, we are going to imagine that this is negligible. So here the host is going to send 2120 bytes. Now This 2120 bytes is going through the network A, and this network A is maximum payload size or MTU is, which is 1200 bytes. So further, this 2120 bytes, as soon as it will receive to this network A, now this network A will subtract these 20 bytes, so it will get all 2100 bytes. Now because it is having an MTU of 1200 bytes, hence it is going to divide this packet into two small packets. The first packet will be having a size of 1200 and the second packet will be having a size of 900. So we are going to send two packets from here. Now these two packets will reach to the network B. Now further, you can imagine that network A is also going to have its own IP header. So this is going to send 1220 bytes and the second packet will be 920 bytes. Okay, so in the network B, again network B is going to remove the IP header. It will get the first 1200 bytes and the second 900 bytes. And here you can see the total payload is 400 bytes per frame is allowed. So this will be divided into three frames, which is 400 bytes, 400 bytes, and then 400 bytes. And this will also be divided into three frames, which is 400 bytes, 400 bytes, and 100 bytes. And then in the network B, we are going to add 20 bytes of header here. In all of them, we are going to add 20 bytes. Here also, we are going to add 20 bytes. So total, it will become how many bytes we are going to transfer. So this, the first will become 420. The second will become 420 bytes. The third will become 120 bytes. The fourth will become 420 bytes. The fifth will become 420 bytes. And the sixth will become 420 bytes. Now they are asking, what is the total IP overhead in the second network for this transmission? So in this transmission, what is the total IP overhead? And what is this IP overhead? So IP overhead means how many bytes you are using in case of header. So you have 20 here, 20 here, 20, 20, 20. You are going to add. So 20 plus 20 plus 20 plus 20. Because we are going to add, use 6 headers of 20 bytes each. So in total, it is going to be 120 bytes. Hence the IP overhead here will be 120 bytes. So which is option number C. I hope that you understood it clearly. If you want me to explain it again, I will do it. Please let me know. The next question they are saying, suppose that the maximum transmit window size for TCP connection is 12,000 bytes. So this is the window size that they are giving. And each packet consists of 2,000 bytes. At some point of time, the connection is in slow start phase with a current transmit window size of 4,000 bytes. Okay. Subsequently, the transmitter receives two acknowledgments. Assuming that no packets are lost and there are no timeouts, what is the maximum possible value of current transmit window size? Okay. So here what you can see here is that TCP, we are using TCP for this connection, and in this connection we are sending total the window size here, the maximum window size here is 12,000 bytes. Okay. Now they are saying at some point in time, the connection is in slow start phase with the current transmit window size of 4,000 bytes. So current transmit window size is 4,000 bytes. So currently we are transmitting two packets here, each of size 2,000 bytes and 2,000 bytes. Okay. And then we are going to receive acknowledgement from this acknowledgement. Now the transmitter receives two acknowledgement, assuming that no packets are lost and there are no timeouts. There are no timeouts. What is the maximum possible value of the current transmit window? So here we should know how this TCP congestion control works. So generally in case of TCP congestion control, first of all, we have a slow start phase. We have a slow start phase. So what is this slow start phase? Slow start phase is when the congestion window size increases exponentially. For example, here, this window size here is 12,000. So window size is 12,000. So first of all, we are going to send one segment, which is of 2000 byte. As soon as we receive the acknowledgement for the first segment, we increase the window size to 2. So this will become 2000 bytes plus 2000 bytes. And as soon as we receive the acknowledgement for this, again we are going to increase the congestion window size. Now we are going to increase the congestion window size exponentially till we reach the size, the time where which is the threshold, till which is reach the threshold. So here, because we have the maximum window size is 12,000, therefore 12,000 divided by 2 is 6,000, so 6,000 will be threshold. So that means first we will be sending 2,000 bytes, then after receiving the acknowledgement we will be sending 4,000 bytes. After receiving the acknowledgement again we have to increase exponentially by 8,000, but we cannot do it to 8,000 because the threshold is 6,000. So we only do slow start phase till we reach the threshold, and after threshold we do the additive increase phase. Okay, I think you have already seen my congestion control videos. Now here they are saying at some point of time the connection is in slow start phase with a current transmit window of 4,000. So currently the transmit window size is of 4,000 bytes, and we received the first acknowledgement here, and again we have to increase the transmit window size to 8,000 bytes, but we cannot do it. Why? Because here the threshold is only of 6,000 bytes. So we can increase the congestion window size to 3 packets, and these 3 packets will be received by the receiver. So here the congestion window size is 6,000 bytes, and as soon as it will be received, so it will send the acknowledgement back, and after sending this acknowledgement, now the sender will again increase the congestion window size, and this time it will be an additive increase. Additive increase. So you should remember TCP congestion control algorithm. In case of TCP congestion control algorithm, first of all we find out what is the threshold, and threshold is basically maximum window size divided by 2. So here the threshold is 12,000 divided by 2 is 6,000, and then from there we get a new value which is again 6,000, for example here. So till 6,000 we are going to do a slow start phase, and in case of slow start phase we do exponential increase. After we reach the threshold we do additive increase phase, where we are going to increase this size by 1 only. So here after getting 2 acknowledgement we are going to send 4 segments here, and these 4 segments are going to have a total size of 8,000 bytes. So they are asking that what is the maximum possible value of the current transmit window after getting 2 acknowledgement. So that is B as the correct answer. So in many places this question is done wrong. So the this is the correct way of solving this question. So in this question a routing table is given. In this routing table we have some destination addresses, and we have some subnet mask, and we have some interfaces. Now on which interface will the router forward the packet which is addressed to this and this? We have to check on which interface these packets will be forwarded. So the first packet is having the IP address which is 128.75.43.16, and here we'll do a bitwise AND with the first subnet mask. It is going to be 255.255.255.0. So we are going to get 128.75.43.0. Okay, so is it matching with the first destination, first IP address of the destination? That is correct, it is matching. So because it is matching, so this packet might get forwarded to the first one. But again, let us check with the second subnet mask, because second subnet mask is much more deeper. So we have the IP address which is 128.75.43.16, and second subnet mask is 255.255.255.128. Now if you do a bitwise AND, you can see here we are going to get 128 dot, here we will get 75 dot, here we will get 43 dot. Now check for the last one. Okay, so in the last case this is representing 16, which is 0000100000. Okay, and this is 128, which is 1000000. So if you do a bitwise AND, you are going to get 0. But you can see this subnet mask is much more defined, and here both the entries are same, and because it is specifically saying to which subnet the packet is forwarding to, it is much more deeper. Hence you can see the first IP first packet will be forwarded to Ethernet 1. So this is the first. Now take the second IP address which is 192.12.17.10. Do a bitwise AND with the first subnet mask. So we are going to get this value, which is 192.12.17.0. It is not matching with the first destination. Now do a bitwise AND with the second subnet mask. So 192.12.17.10 and second subnet mask is 255.255.255.128. So bitwise AND will return 192.12.17.0. Again, this is not matching with this address, so it cannot be forwarded to the first two interfaces. Now let us check with the third interface. Now here the third interface is all 255s. So we are going to get exactly the same address. Therefore, this exact same address must match. But here this last will not match. Therefore, the second one will be forwarded to Ethernet 2. Because if it is not matching with any of them, so it will be forwarded to a default destination. So we can see this packet, which is 128.75.43.16, it will be forwarded to the Ethernet 1. And the second packet, which is 192.12.17.10, it will be forwarded to Ethernet 2. So the correct answer here is option number A, which is Ethernet 1 and Ethernet 2. Now check out the next question here. They are saying, consider three IP networks. So consider three IP networks, which is A, B, and C. The host A in network A sends a message each containing 180 bytes of application data to host C in network C. So we have three networks. Assuming this is representing the network A, this is representing the network B, and this is representing the network C. So host A in network A sent a messages each containing 180 bytes of application data to host C. So here we have application layer data is 180 bytes. Now TCP prefixes a 20 bytes header. This passes through intermediate network B, and the maximum packet size including 20 bytes IP header in each network is given. So here the maximum packet size here is 1000. Here the maximum packet size is only 100. And here the maximum packet size is 1000. Okay. So the third network, the maximum packet size is very less as compared to the first two networks. Now they are saying, the network A and B are connected through a 1 Mbps link. So these two networks are connected to 1 Mbps link. And the second network is connected to 512 Kbps link. So this is kilobits per second. Okay. So assuming that the packets are correctly delivered, how many bytes including the header are delivered in the IP layer at the destination of one application message? In the best case, consider only the data packets. Okay. So you should know how this question is formulated. Now you can see that we have to send a only, just change the color of the pen. So here we have to send 180 bytes. So this is an application data. Now this data will go to the transport layer. So in the transport layer, we are going to add 20 bytes of transport layer header. Then this will go through the network layer. In the network layer, again, we are going to add 20 bytes of network layer header. So which is going to make this as 220 bytes of data. And here in this 220 bytes, this network header is only 20 bytes. Now, when this packet will be sent to the network B, here in the network B, the MTU is very less. So in the network B, we are going to remove the network layer header. So in the network B, we are going to get 200 bytes of data. Now, because we have an MTU of 100, therefore we have to divide this 200 bytes into multiple smaller bytes. So we have to divide it to 3 bytes, which is 80 plus 20, which is again 80 plus 20, and here also we are going to divide it to 40 plus 20. Why I'm dividing it to 80 plus 20? Because you can see here they have already mentioned that the maximum packet size including 20 bytes of IP header, including 20 bytes of IP header, this including is important. So this maximum packet size here should be 100 bytes, but this should include the IP header. So this 200 bytes will be divided into 3 bytes, which is 80 plus 20. This is 20 is IP header. This is IP header. And this is 80 plus 20. This is 80 plus 40 plus 20. So which is 100 bytes of packet. The second packet will be of 100 bytes. And the third packets will be of 60 bytes. And then it will be sent to the network C. So network C should receive 3 packets, which is 100 bytes and 60 bytes. So total amount of data that this C should receive is 260 bytes. Okay. Now they are saying, they're already asking How many bytes including the headers are delivered to the IP layer as the destination of one application message in the network C? So in the network C, we should get 260 bytes. So correct answer is option number B. Okay. I hope that you understood this one. If you do not understood, then please go and follow my videos on fragmentation. Now look at this second part of the same question. Now they are saying, what is the rate at which the application data is transferred to host C, ignoring the errors acknowledgement and other overheads? So you already know that we have three networks, which is the network A, we have a network B, and we have a network C. Now this, through this network A, the link is 1 Mbps. From network B to C, the link is 512 kbps. Okay, and here initially we wanted to send 180 bytes. Then to this 180 bytes we added 20 bytes of TCP header, and then we added 20 bytes of IP header. Further, in the network B, this packet was divided into 3 packets, which is of 80 plus 20 byte of IP headers, 80 plus 20 byte of IP headers, and 40 plus 20 byte of IP header. So which is total of 260 bytes. So originally we wanted to send only 180 bytes, but here you can see we are sending 260 bytes, and here the speed is 512 kbps. Therefore you can see it as 512 multiplied by 1000 bits per second. Okay, and this is given in terms of bytes, so convert this byte to bits. So this is 260 multiplied by 8 bits. Okay, so here we are getting 260 multiplied by 8 divided by 512 multiplied by 1000, which is equal to 13 by 3200. Fine. So this is you can see we have divided the total size of the packet divided by bandwidth in this network, so we can get how much is the transfer time, right? But you can clearly see here they are asking about the transfer rate, the rate at which we are sending the data. So the rate is, we wanted to send 180, right? So to send 180, this is the time taken. So the rate will be total size divided by time. Size divided by time. Okay. So total size that we wanted to send is 180. Divided by how much time it took, it is 13 divided by 3200, so which is approximately 180 multiplied by 3200 divided by 13. So you can easily calculate this value. So this value will be 44.3 kbps, or you can say 354.46 kilobits per second. So this is given in terms of bytes. Fine. So you have to convert this byte into bits. So correct answer to this question is option number B, that is 354.5 kbps. I hope that you understood this question very easily. So this was 2004 questions. Now let us look at 2005 questions.